Good afternoon. 75 years ago, Aldous Huxley predicted a dark and dystopian future in which technology is used to control society. Now, I think it will. But we can turn this into a positive future if we combine technological innovation with moral imagination. Now, the technologies that will mark our future are mainly smart and intelligent technologies, which means that, to a great extent, they are able to operate themselves autonomously. Devices talking with each other in the Internet of Things, software that is starting to learn, machine learning, artificial intelligence, and the combination of both is smart robotics. Now, these technologies are leading us into a new era. We are shifting from an era where we, human beings, needed to learn how to deal with machines, like taking driving classes to be able to drive a car, or getting a training to be able to operate a machine, to an age in which the machine is learning how to deal with people. Like self-driving cars, navigating between cyclists, pedestrians, and other cars. Or, in industrial environments, cobots working together with people, able to understand instructions from the human operators. So it's the machine working, learning how to work with people. This evolution to autonomous technology and robots intensifies the relation between two key drivers of our future: ethics and technology. Now, ethics is basically about one question. What should I do? How should I behave? If someone is in need, do I help or not? If I find a wallet with money, do I take the money or do I bring it back to the police department or the owner? So this is what ethics is about. And ethics implies that you have a conviction on what is good behavior and what is bad behavior. We all have different answers to that question, but it is about having an idea about good and bad. Now, technology influences our behavior. That makes technology never neutral. Let me repeat that. Technology is not neutral. Just to show you, if we look around, many things we make have actually built-in morals. They are an extension of our assumption on what is good behavior and what is bad behavior. Like the speed radar. It is there to force you to do the right thing, which is, of course, driving safely. So there's not only an Internet of Things, there's also something like an ethics of things. Now, if you prefer the subway or the train, you won't need to escape either, because then you find these electric gates. You can only enter if you do the right thing, which is, of course, paying your ticket. Or if you go to Holland, to the Efteling, then you can find this talking trash can. His name is Hollebollegijs, and he says, papier hier, which literally means put your trash in my mouth, but then a bit shorter. And this is a machine literally telling you what is the right behavior. Of course, this is collecting your garbage. Now, these are all examples of nudging techniques. And nudging is giving you a push in the right direction. But you still need to do it. Now, that changes with autonomous technology. With autonomous technology, we are moving from nudging to judging technology, which means that the technology itself needs to make a decision on what is now, in a certain situation, the good thing to do and the bad thing to do. Like self-driving cars in traffic, like autonomous weapons in combat situations, and like all kind of software already today, making decisions on whether you get a loan or an insurance or a mortgage. And secondly, you, as a user, won't be able to escape the judgment of the technology. Now let's have a look at how far this could go.
Inside here is 3 grams of shaped explosive. This is how it works. Did you see that? That little bang is enough to penetrate the skull and destroy the contents. They used to say guns don't kill people. People do. Well, people don't. They get emotional, disobey orders, aim high. Let's watch the weapons make the decisions. And trust me, these were all bad guys. Now that is an airstrike of surgical precision.
Let's watch the weapons make the decisions. Do we want that? Do we want robots to decide on who gets to live and who dies? Is this our brave new world, our reality? Not yet. The movie is made by a group of AI experts of the Future of Life Institute, warning us for the dangers of AI-driven drones. But the only thing that stands between this fiction and our reality is our choice, is our values. It's not about the technical possibility, it's about the moral responsibility. Because every technical feature that is presented in this video exists. AI technology, drone technology, facial recognition. We only need to put it together, and that is a moral question. But they are making a plea to ban this technology. And this might be a good idea when technology has bad intentions. But even technology with good intentions might need to take decisions with severe ethical consequences. And this is tough fiction. Almost 2 years ago, for the first time ever, sadly, a person died in an accident with a semi-autonomous car of Tesla. Now, apparently, he ignored a warning sign that he should take over the steering wheel again. He didn't and crashed into a truck and died. Now, imagine that you were in that car and there is no steering wheel anymore. And the car drives you into the city and you come up at the junction. And suddenly, someone's grandmother is crossing the street. And she has her grandchild with her. And the only option the car has, of course, it will brake, but it can happen within the braking distance, is crashing you into a roadblock. What do you think the self-driving cars should do? I know that it's not about the grandmother. It's about you, and you, and you, and you. It's about everybody. Yes, and it's also about grandmothers, which are on the left there. The question is, or the thing is with these scenarios, they're too much used to say, look, this is dangerous technology, we don't want this. No, we should have this kind of technology. But they do show us that we cannot solve these ethical issues with just technical expertise or mathematical expertise. We will need moral imagination in order to align technology with ethics. And that will need to come from us, from human beings. With moral imagination, I mean that you look into questions, societal issues, ethical issues, in the innovation process. Who might get affected by our innovation? Positively, negatively? What kind of impacts can we expect? And we need a diverse audience to look at these questions, like another speaker said earlier on. And what values might get supported and challenged by our innovation? A challenged value of self-driving cars is not safety. They will be a lot more, they will be a lot safer than human drivers. But moral justice is a challenged value in this technology. And it's only by addressing these questions in the innovation process that we can come up with solutions that bring ethics in line with technology, like this one. Because I think this is the mindset we will need to prevent the dark, brave new world and to create a bright future. Namely, redesigning technology to bring ethics and technology in line. Like the distrust that might occur when you cross the street, because today we often make eye contact when we cross the street. This makes it possible to do this in the future with self-driving cars. Now, we won't always be able to solve these questions, moral dilemmas, with smileys on self-driving cars. The other option we have is embedding technology with ethics. And again, we can do so. We need proactive ethics, which means ethics, ethical thinking before the technology is even there or even used. The German government brought together a group of AI experts, ethicists, policymakers, even bishops, to come up with a list of ethical rules that future technology, future automated vehicles will need to comply with. Like, it's more than three, but like always protecting human lives. And that if not avoidable, that it will never hit someone on purpose. That is the difference between killing and letting die. I think that's a very valuable principle to program into self-driving cars. It will do everything to avoid damage, but sometimes it might not be able to avoid that. For instance, when there is a human mistake. And that you create a moral black box, comparable to planes, that if anything goes wrong, that at least you can go back into decision-making and look what went wrong and who was responsible. This way, we can trust technology, and that is what we need. We don't need to fear technology, but we also don't need to fear ethicists. We only need to fear technology without ethics. So here we are. Technology will be forced to make moral judgments in the future. Now, we have two options. Either we let those judgments be made by the technology and by calculation, or we use our human software, our moral imagination, to bring ethics and technology in line. Because in the end, our future is created with our moral imagination or by our lack of it. I say we better make use of it. Thank you very much.